It's good to see everybody. Every year, if you see I'm in a t-shirt today, every year, Operation Christmas Child, as a pastor, sends me Operation Christmas Child t-shirt. So this is mine. It says something about joy and gifts. I read it this morning, but anyway, it's a wonderful program, and I heard Leslie telling y'all about everything in the week, so I won't go through that again, but it's hard to believe that it's that time, isn't it? Anybody else in shock? You know, I can't get over it. We're doing Operation Christmas Child Boxes. I'm going to talk to you in a little bit about the Thanksgiving program where we bring in all the food. And the Thanksgiving dinner's the 15th. We'll be eating Thanksgiving dinner the 22nd. The Christmas sales have started, and if you go up and down the radio dial, you'll find five stations that are playing Christmas songs. You know what a shocker it is to get in the car and hear Michael Bublé singing White Christmas? And the 1st and 2nd of November, that it's there if you want it. And I got to tell you, I'm just shocked by it all because as I told some people today, I think that the 4th of July was about 3 days ago. So I'm lost in some kind of time warp. But we're going to start a series this week for the month of October about a science that is called apologetics. And a lot of people don't know what apologetics is. Apologetics is the study of teaching Jesus Christ. It's about how to meet people and talk to people about Jesus Christ. And it's funny because the church is kind of a strange body. Everybody knew that Tuesday was Halloween, right? When last Tuesday, October 31st, Halloween, everybody was. But very few people knew that it was Reformation Day. Raise your hand if you knew it was Reformation Day. The reason you're sitting here in this church today is because of Reformation Day. Did you know that? A priest named Martin Luther went up to the Catholic Church and the main office at that time and took a nail and knocked up a whole thesis about the problems that was wrong where the church separated from the Bible. And the Bible says this, and it was about baptism, and actually, to be honest with you, it was actually even about reading the Bible. Because at that time, the church decided that the people were too stupid to understand the Bible, and they didn't want people reading the Bible because if you read it, you couldn't understand it. They had to explain it to you and all this stuff. So Martin Luther's kind of a hero to all of us who love God. And of course people say, well, what happened? Well, it wasn't too long after that they killed him. They were pretty offended with what he had to say. Because most of the time, when people actually teach the truth of the Bible, it doesn't go over well with a lot of people. Because you look today, and you think, why do we have so many churches? Because have you ever noticed that there's a ton of churches? I mean, there's even new churches coming in all the time in the towns. And most of the reason people pick this church or this church is because they're uncomfortable with the Bible. And they're looking for a way to get to this or get to that that gets away from the scripture because I really don't like that. And I really don't like that it says that. And so they pick this. And it's come to the point where in the year 2017 that you can actually pick a church that is either evangelical or non-evangelical. Did you know that? Did you know you have a choice that you can pick one of those two kinds of churches? And all the denominations that fall into the line of evangelical, what do you know what those are? Those are those lunatic people that are always out there trying to tell you about Jesus. They're always trying to talk to you about God. They're always trying to get you to get close to Jesus. And they're out there working on it and praying about it. And how do we make a difference in this? And how do we change the community? And then there's the non-evangelicals. And the non-evangelicals, what they want to do is they want to do some nice things so people love them, but they don't want to step on anybody's toes. And they don't want to teach the Bible. So they just kind of go out in the community and do some nice things, maybe get some food together from the food pantry or hand out some blankets and stuff, but they're not going to ever talk to you about the Bible. Okay? Now, that's what we've got. We're looking at those two things. But here's what's really scary. George Barna reports that in the evangelical church, only 47% of people in the evangelicals tell people about Jesus. So that means that the message of Jesus is split 50% right between the evangelicals and the non-evangelicals. And then you basically split the evangelicals 50%. So it's like only 25% of people who are followers of Christ will tell anybody about Jesus. Does anybody else think that's kind of sad? Because here's the thing. You can take the scripture and you can do whatever you want. You can decide, you know, you can do Thomas Jefferson, and you can take your Bible and you can cut this verse out. You can cut this verse out. You can cut this verse out. But the Apostle Paul says on 11 different occasions that if you don't tell people about Jesus, that you can't call yourself a follower of Christ. Did you know that? I mean, this is bold face, right in your face. If you're not willing to tell anybody about it, and Jesus says, if you're ashamed of me on that last day, I will be ashamed of you. And so it kind of gets lost how people get away from that and don't want to do that. And they don't want to talk about it. Then, you know, they quote scripture that there's two things you never talk to with people, religion and politics. You know where that is in the Bible, right? It's right in the chapter known as Shakespeare. You know? Not scripture at all, but people will change into that. So the thing is that we realize that as Christians, we have to go out and live our life about Jesus, but not just live. There are times we have to talk about it. And we have to talk about our scripture. We have to talk about our faith, and we have to share that with people in a way that we know. And a lot of people say, well, I just don't know it. And that's what we're going to kind of have a little class in this month. We're going to have a class in what to talk to people about. And the first week, we're going to talk about who is God. Because a lot of things that people want to do is they accept Christ. New Christians are the best. They run out, and they just want to tell everybody about Jesus. So fresh and so exciting, and they're on fire so bad, and they want to go tell everybody about Jesus. And the thing is that as they're dumping all this on people, it's just great. I'm so excited. You're so excited. Because it's like we are, right? We get a new restaurant, you have a new kind of pizza. Hey, you gotta try this pizza place. Hey, I got this kind of car. Hey, they got this kind of sale on jeans over at the Levi thing. Hey, you know what I mean? We want to tell everybody the good news about everything in the world, but hey, I got a way that is eternal life. I got a way that you'll never die. I have a way that you can go through every day of your life happy and never be alone and know that you're friends with the very creator of the universe. But people don't want to share that kind of stuff. And when they do, they're not sure how to do it. But you can't go dump Jesus immediately without talking about God. And that's one of the first mistakes that we make. People have to believe in God. It was a funny story I read it years ago. They went to an island and they translated the Bible into the New Testament for all these natives. And they translated the New Testament for them. And they gave them the New Testament. And they just, all the people accepted Christ and they baptized the whole island, you know, and they left and they were so excited. And like 5 or 6 years later, they all went back. And when they went back, they were sacrificing chickens to Jesus and all kinds of stuff. And they said, what's the mistake? They never learned about the Old Testament. They never learned about God. They never learned that God was a God that accepted sacrifices, and then he thought everybody's sacrifices were hypocritical. Because they didn't really care if that lamb died, right? Don't really care if that bull dies. Hey, it's easy for me to toss this much money in. Here, you can have some of my grain. They really didn't care. It really didn't get down and hurt. It wasn't that kind of sacrifice, but you know what? It hurts to see Jesus on the cross. It hurts to give up your son to show people how much you love them. So you have to understand God to understand that. And that's what we're going to talk about today. When you get a chance to talk to people, get a chance to teach people. What do you teach them? And today we're going to start with who is God. And before we do, let's go to God's Word of Prayer. God, we just thank you so much for this day. We thank you for the chance to talk about you, because it's so exciting to tell people about you. It is the truth. People say so badly they want to hear the truth, and you are the truth. And we love to tell about you. We love to tell about Jesus. And we want to see lives change. We want to see people come to know you. But first, Lord, we have to teach you before we can even teach Jesus. And so, Lord, help us today to touch us. We have just a short time to talk together. But help us to see things in the scriptures and to find ways to talk about you. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the first thing is, what would you say? What are you saying to people about God? What do you, well, he's God and he looks just like George Burns. Right? That's for the old people that are out there. If you remember the movies Oh God from the 70s. And but now it's changed, and I can't think of the actor's name today, the way things go in my mind. But now in the last few movies, God's been the guy that always voices the commercials.
Morgan Freeman,
yeah. God's now Morgan went from George Burns to Morgan Freeman shortly after George Burns went to see God. So anyway, but if I asked you who God is, today I'm a non-believer, and I come up to you and I say, who is God? Who is God? What is your answer? What is your answer to people who say, who is God? And most faithful believers would say, oh, he's my creator. You know? And so the thing is if you say my creator, the first thing that's going to happen is you're going to get questions like, what do you know about that? Are you ready for those? Are you ready for those? What do you know about God creating you? Second thing is that most of us would say is he's my Savior. God is my Savior. What did he save you from? Right? See how apologetics gets? Because this is the thing. These questions I'm asking you, I'm not asking you this to be mean today. I'm talking to you. This is what I do for a living. And it's what I do with my life. And I did it before I was ever a preacher. Because I was one of those people, since I was very young, I've been very vocal about talking to people about Jesus. And so I know questions that people ask you. A lot of people will say, he's my friend. Well, what's he look like? What's it sound like when he talks to you? And then the scariest thing that has come across that the Christian church has been teaching for the last 200 years, that they don't teach it right. Who is God? He's my judge. And see, there's a problem in that right there, because I'm going to tell you something. That's why the world doesn't like him, and that's why they invent things. Do you hear them invent things about the scriptures? They say that God hates women. Well, if you say that God hates women, you've never read the Bible. Because God truly loves women. God respects women. God had women discover that Jesus had risen from the dead. Amen? And they say that God loves slavery. And that God promotes slavery. And those people have never read the Bible, because God said, if you're a slave, stay a slave. And they say, see, that shows you right there that God loves slavery. Well, I have to be quite honest with you. That book was written 2,000 years before American slavery, and there's never been a slavery in the history of the world as evil and mean as American slavery. When a country decided to do slavery and do it up mean and nasty and horrible, we did it. And it is something that we still feel the shame from. We were the first to separate families and to sell people's babies. All the slavery that you read about in the Bible was people working jobs to work off debt and do things for people. Everything was about being a good master. So see, people don't know who God is, and they think that he just wants to send them to hell. And that he spends every day trying to think of how to send them to hell. And the sad thing is how many Christians think each day that they get up and that God is trying to trip them up today so he can send them to hell. And like I said, if you look at that cross, that cross never had to happen if God was planning to take you to hell. So how do we convey these things to people? How do we teach things to people. And who do we teach them who God is? And we start out in Exodus 3, 13 through 15. And it says, Exodus 3, 1 through 6, I'm sorry. One day Moses was taking care of the sheep and the goats of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. And Moses decided to lead them across the desert to Sinai, the holy mountain. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him from a burning bush. Moses saw that the bush was on fire, but it was not burning up. "This is strange," he said to himself. "I'll go over and see why the bush isn't burning up." When the Lord saw Moses coming near the bush, he called him by name, and Moses answered, "Here I am." God replied, "Don't come any closer. Take off your sandals. The ground where you are standing is holy. I am the God who was worshipped by your ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." Moses was afraid to look at God, and so he hid his face. So the first thing that God says here is that Moses hears that God is the God of his ancestors. And when I study that, read that, do I really know what that means? What's important that God is the God of his ancestors? And that's what it is with a lot of us. We're looking for the God of our ancestors because it's a fulfillment of Scripture. Right here, what Moses hears is that, okay, you know about Genesis. You've been taught this your whole life. You know about the creation of the world. You know about the flood. You know about Noah. I was the God that walked with the two original people, Adam and Eve. That's it. I'm the God that walked with Adam and Eve. I'm the God that got Noah on the ark and destroyed the world and built it back again. I am that God. And I'm the God of Isaac and Jacob. And the great stories of Joseph and what happened through the famine and the dreams that he predicted. I am that God. I have done all of those things. That God that is there. Because, you know, I love listening to Elton John. Elton John's got a song called Leave On. And it says, "The New York Times said God is dead," which I guess was an actual newspaper article that happened during World War II. When all the things were happening. And there are times that people must feel as things are going terrible that, you know, I don't see any evidence of God. God must be dead. God is not dead. He is very much alive. And we can see this in our ancestors. And we can see this in the Bible. We can see the things that people tell us about God. But it's a fulfillment of who he is. And it's one of the things that we have to tell. God has been through the beginning, and we can take them up and tell them how he's always been there. In 13 through 15, Moses answered, "I will tell the people of Israel that the God of their ancestors worship has sent me to them, but what should I say if they ask me your name?" And God said to Moses, "I am the eternal God, so tell them that the Lord, whose name is I Am, has sent you. This is my name forever, and it is the name that people must use from now on. I Am. I Am." The name that is so intense that they were afraid to speak it from their lips. You listen today, and you hear people talk, and you hear people say, trying to be cool. They see something, oh God, you know, and you have to realize that this is something that people were afraid to even say from their lips, because they knew the power. They knew how incredible God was. And then as we study the Bible even more, we know that one of the things that Jesus did through the Sadducees and the Pharisees in the tub of fury was they said, "Tell us who you are." And he said, "I am. I am." The very essence of everything. How did the universe create? How did everything start? How did earth come into shape? How did the sun start? I am. Everything is from I am. The beginning of everything. And we know that. And people say, "Well, you know so much about I am. Where can I see I am?" And God even tells us that in his word. 19:1-4. "The heavens keep telling the wonders of God, and the skies declare what he has done. Each day informs the following day. Each night announces the next. They don't speak a word, and there's never a sound of a voice, yet their message reaches all the earth, and it travels around the world in a tent that is set up for the sun." All you have to do is look outside, and you see God. All you have to do is look around, and you see God. You see God in people. You see God in trees. You see God in birds. You see God in animals. You go to the zoo, you see God. You go to the ocean, you see God. I was on Facebook this morning, and Rick Scheidler's somewhere warm down in Florida, and he said, if you wonder about seeing the God, look out at the ocean and the sky and where they meet. And he said, you see God. You see God. You know, it's everywhere, and that's what God said. You know, people say, well, how can I be held responsible for knowing God? Because you see. You see the stars. You've been out on a really wonderful starry night where you can see every star that just went on forever. And God made each one of those by hand. And it's like I said, sometimes I get to talk about things and people think I'm nuts, but you know, how do you see God in creation? And I've still said to me, the greatest thing ever, and I know you've all heard me say this a million times, but once I learned it, I can't get over it. God is just incredible and breastfeeding a new baby. Bye, Tanner. You heard me, you got hungry. God invented this sugar. And a woman's breast right after birth produces a sugar for 24 hours. If she did not have that sugar, the baby would never drink the milk because it can't handle just the taste of normal breast milk. At the end of the 24-hour period, the woman stops producing that sugar. You want to tell me that's an accident? You want to tell me that just happened? No, and you know, I tell that to people and they're like, whoa. You know, you got to wake up. You got to realize there's no science that can tell you why that would just happen for 24 hours. That's insanity. That's crazy. That's unbelievable. That's proof of a God. That shows a creator who's a mastermind that I can see everywhere and everything. So we explain to them and we teach them that there's a God that is a creator and who has been evident in all the things that he's done. And the first thing they say is, well, this creator, I'm just a peon. Why would he care about me? And that's where you go next. You know that this God cares for you. Do you understand and know that this God, that we're talking about how powerful he is, all the things that he does, he loves you. Now, this is where you got to separate. This is one of the biggest selfish parts that you get in the world. And when you're training people this, I want you to be selfish. I don't want you to say God loves America. I don't want you to say God loves Israel. I don't want you to talk about God loves Canada and anything. I want you to specifically get in their faces and say, God loves me. And you want to know something? He loves you. I'm not talking about your kids. I'm not talking about your family right now. He loves all these people. He loves you. Because it's very tough for us to understand that God could possibly love us. God is so big and I am so small. Remember that song when you were kids? God is so big. Right? And you know, how can he love something so small? But as David wrote, you, Lord God, are my protector. In Psalm 7:1-2. Rescue me and keep me safe from all who chase me, or else they will rip me apart like lions attacking the victim, and no one will save me. David had a very special relationship with God. He talked to God. And he asked for God for protection. And as you read about David, it's easy to teach them. And you can go through the Bible and just read how he protected people. We can even get in later where at night he came in and unlocked jail cells and let people out, didn't he? So they wouldn't be executed the next day. I mean, we can go through the Bible and show things over and over, but you know what's even better? How many times has God protected you? Jim asked in Sunday school today, he said, is there ever a time you were afraid? And after my leukemia was over and everything, I took Nate and Luke, they were like 7 or 8 maybe, and I took them sled riding. And I took them out of a place where there was nobody around or anything on this big hill, and I went out there. And we went out, and I mean, the temperature was dropping. We were going down this hill. We had the time of our lives, and believe it or not, this will be hard for you to let me understand, there was no such thing as cell phones. Can you Can you believe that? There was actually a time in this world where people lived without cell phones. It was called the heaven period. But anyway, so we get done with this sled ride, and I go up and I get the boys in the car, and I turn the car key, nothing. We're miles from anywhere. And the boys are laughing and stuff, saying, "Come on, Dad, we're going to go home and get some cocoa. Let's get going." And I didn't want to see that. I was about to cry. Because I thought, well, we're going to be one of those stories of people who freeze to death. You know what I mean? That you read about and hope they have fun before they die. And I just started praying. I prayed. Nathan looked at me and said, "What are you praying about?" I said, "Nothing." And I'm scared. Nathan was very panicky at that age. And I got them praying, and I turned the car key. And boom. Now, I don't have any clue about cars. Kyle and Steve will tell you, I'm clueless about cars. I don't know anything. And everything that I did know, they decided it was stupid and they took out. Like, in my lifetime, when the car wouldn't start like that, you took the black thing off the top and put a screwdriver in the carburetor and got far away so it wouldn't burn the hair off your arm, because it did burn the hair off my arm. And the car would fire right up. Remember them days? Those were good days. I don't care if it was 6 miles to the gallon, I knew what to do. But you want to know something? I knew God started. Because I know it protects me. I know it protects his babies. And I know that. And I believe that. We need more people understanding that God is the protector. 7:10-13, David goes on and says, "You God are my shield, the protector of everyone whose heart is right. You see that justice is done, and each day you take revenge. Whenever your enemies refuse to change their ways, you sharpen your sword and string your bow. Your deadly arrows are ready with flaming tips." Isn't it nice to know that when you feel like everybody's ready to attack you, that God is standing behind you with an army? He's not going to let this stuff befall you. He's not going to let it hurt you. You see, he is ready to see that we have justice. That's what God's all about. We think the world's so full of injustice. He's ready to see that we have justice because he cares so much. You see, this God that you think of as so huge and creating all those things, his greatest desire in the whole world is to be with you. I'm not talking about the congregation. I could go through and start going off on your names and saying each one of you, his desire is to be with you. His desire is to be with you. His desire is to be with you. That is what he lives for every day. He wants to be with every one of his creation. And that's not what the media reports is. You know, how does God let this happen? How does God do this? How does God? Trust me. So much of our problems is what we choose. Amen? It's stuff that we've chosen. It's stuff that we've picked. It's stuff that we've wanted out of selfishness. Or you know, how we are. It's not stuff that God has set up for us. But he wants to be with you. And the very answer to what is Christianity is that God wants to be with you. That is Christianity. Christianity is what we're going to discuss for 1 month. I hope you'll come back and bring friends. I hope you'll use this for yourself. The answer to what this is Christianity. It's why there's a Jesus. All of that is about God wanting to be with us. You see, your Creator wants to be with you and spend every day with you. He wants to spend every day with you here on earth because of your acknowledgement, your praying, and your teaching. I have to tell you a little funny story about myself last night. If you tell me that something is going to happen on Sunday late in the night, I think it's Sunday night. So I got a wonderful email. How many people got a wonderful email from the power company? saying that we were not going to have electricity on Sunday from 12:30 till 5:30 or 6 in the morning. How many of you got that email? Yeah, and you know, I instantly understood that that meant tonight. Well, to the power company, that meant last night. And Sammy and I had just finished a very moving experience. I watched a movie called The Wall, which I still have no